I've always believed that some mysteries in life are best left unexplored. A conviction I apparently failed to pass on to my daughter, Molly, shown here trying to save a wounded blender. Not that the loss of an appliance is so tragic, especially when she took to college with her 17 years ago. If it were me, I'd give it up for junk and buy a new one. But Molly likes to think she can fix everything. Flat tires, furniture, broken dishes, broken hearts. Plus, she hates to shop, which is fortunate given the condition of her bank account. The amazing thing about her, though, is when she really needs a job, she'll find one if she doesn't electrocute herself first. There it goes. I'll buy her a new one for Christmas. I'll keep the earrings for myself.
Are you sure you have the right apartment?
12A. Want me to come back later?
Oh, no, no. Come on in. I mean, if it needs to be done.
Believe me, I wouldn't be here if it didn't.
Kitchen?
Gosh, no, I haven't seen many bugs around here recently.
Yeah, it's one of their tricks. They don't let you see them. Then it's too late. This will only take a second.
Hello? Who? Bill! Bill, hi!
I'm pleased to hear you're still not losing your inability to speak.
Oh, where have you been? And how on earth did you find me?
Not without some difficulty. Your former employer was reluctant somewhat in parting with your private numbers. But I was a bulldog.
Oh, I'm certainly glad about that. Bill, is there something that I could do for you?
That depends upon your present status.
Well, my status is still unencumbered, if that's what you mean.
Are you seeking cumbrance?
What kind of cumbrance did you have in mind?
Perhaps you could consider something I have to dangle in front of you.
What? Could you run that by me again?
I am proposing to offer you a job.
A job.
Are there elephants in your room?
Oh, Bill, listen, you know, I would love to sit and chat about this all day, but I think that I really have to go. What? An hour would be fine. 128, right. Bill, I have got to go. What the hell are you doing?
That ought to fix them.
Look at my kitchen. It's bug-free.
No charge.
No, wait just a minute. What is the name of your company?
This isn't a business with me, ma'am. It's a mission.
Boy, war is hell.
Bit of jonquil in the air today. Maybe gardenias. Something new we're wearing?
Oh, you could say that.
What's it called?
Tetrahydrodimethylhydrazine.
Let me see. That'd be...
your bug spray.
Uh-huh. Yeah. One of your more exotic fragrances.
Is it really that noticeable? No, come on, Davey. I've got a job interview. How bad is it?
Well, no sense getting a dither about it. The way I figure it, in this city, by the time you finish walking through the bus fumes and construction grime and the stench of that kebab stuff they sell off of them carts, you can't help but come out smelling about the same as everybody else. Maybe that's why they call it a melting pot.
You know, that's what I love about you, Davey. You really inspire such confidence.
Maybe you could try this.
Oh. Fine. Any better?
Well, that all depends.
What?
What kind of job you're bucking for? Anyway, it ain't how you smell that matters.
Thank you, Davy. I'll keep that in mind.
Well, step up, please. I ain't got all day.
Here. Hey, Molly.
Fred. What's happened to you? Did you spend the night in a flop house?
No. A bench. Sort of got locked out of my place last night.
Uh-huh. With all your worldly possessions.
Kirsten and I had a sort of,
She threw you out?
No, nothing like that.
Oh, okay, I'll guess again. She threw you out?
Maybe I forgot her birthday or something. I don't know. It's a big deal to Swedes, I guess. Anyway, I thought maybe I'd drop by and see if I could get cleaned up, but I see you're on your way out, so...
Oh, no, it's okay. I mean, you can't spend the rest of the day looking like someone who's just arrived from hell. Got an extra key in here somewhere. There's a razor in the tub. There's some cold pasta in the fridge. Just take it easy on the long-distance calls, okay?
Molly, I need a favor.
Well, yeah, I thought that's what this was.
No, it's a big favor.
Uh-oh.
See, you're the only person who could talk to her. And what I was wondering was how you'd maybe feel about going to see Kirsten and...
I must be in the twilight zone.
You know, talking to her, you know, about me and things. And oh, you could communicate with her. You're two women. You have a lot in common. And you know how I am. You know, so I thought maybe you could straighten her out, you know, about... the way it is sometimes.
The way it is?
Yeah.
Yeah, Fred, I'm going to pretend you never asked me this.
Now wait, let me finish.
What? Oh, believe me, you are finished.
Oh, Molly, just wait. Look, I know this is kind of tough on you, but I have got nowhere else to go. We're friends, right? You said so yourself. I mean, I'm supposed to be getting married in 2 weeks.
Oh, right. So you think you'll send your ex-wife in to bail you out with your fiancé? I mean, this is a joke, right? This is some kind of big cosmic joke? You must be out of your mind.
So you're saying you'd rather not?
I gotta go. You want this or not?
Nah. I'll wash up in the fountain.
Fine.
Molly. You move like a swan. Lucky guy to see her every day.
And once again we are here, having traveled fully in a round circle.
I feel like Alice in Wonderland.
I'm not knowing this person.
This place is very large. I mean, for a single guy. What happened to that place I sold you?
Alas, my face is red. My accountant says I have no choice. Move to places with more rooms, he says. So I move. Then he says, move again. So I do. I am thinking there is no rest for the wealthy.
Boy, the jogging paraphernalia business must be booming.
As they say, it is not precisely chopped livers.
No. What's up there?
112 bedrooms.
Well, you must be kidding.
Must I always be grim as a reaper?
Oh, well, no. I just never took you for a guy with a sense of humor.
That is because you're so gullibillible.
Ah, no, you see, the word is gullible.
Exactly. And now shall we get down and talk of the turkeys?
Yes.
In 2 days, I shall embark upon a tour of many cities for 11 weeks. There I will be meeting many clients who will be lusting to put my equipment upon the top of their shelves. There will be much wining and dining.
Oh, I see. Oh, well, you're looking for a gal Friday. Someone to order flowers, chat with the wives, bat her eyelashes at the clients.
Oh, yes. Eyelash batting is very, very important.
Yeah. Well, to tell you the truth, it's not really the kind of thing
I hope I'm not barking up the wrong street. It would simply be an adventure. I would join you to my hip.
Okay, that's certainly a very...
But I must warn you, in matters of payment, I am cheap as a suit.
Ah, well, I'm not really all that sure.
I can only offer you $2,000 a week, not a penny more.
$2,000?
$2,500 then. You see, you have me in the barrel.
No, really, $2,000 sounds fine. Can I think it over?
$3,000 is my final offer. After that, $3,500.
No, hold it. It's really not about the money.
Never mind. You can explain this to me at dinner tonight when you take me to the dry cleaners.
Look, Bill, why me? I mean, I don't have any experience doing this. Why wouldn't you pick someone else?
Would someone else bring to mind a fragile orchid whose petals unfold in the soft mist of a gentle jungle rain?
Nope. Nobody else could do that. Except maybe Jane Seymour.
It's called Chicken Surprise.
There's no chicken in it.
That's the surprise.
Mom, look, you know, I can't afford to pass this job up. I mean, $3,500 a week jobs just don't fall out of the trees.
I understand completely. Never have children.
Now you tell me.
Mom, look, I know you were looking forward to our taking classes together. So was I. But just because I'm going to be away for a while doesn't mean you can't do it by yourself.
Are you out of your mind? Of course I'm going to do it by myself.
Oh, well,
the day I need someone to walk me to school, I'll hire a crossing guard.
Well, so then you really don't mind.
Which camel will you be leaving on?
Mother, I will be in touch daily.
The Black Hole of Calcutta has an area code. That'll be 1122.
What, for blue meat?
Blue plate special. $10. Take it or leave it. I simply don't understand what kind of businessman hires a secretary who doesn't know the first thing about his business.
It's running shoes and sweatsuits. I can learn about that.
Sounds to me as though he had something else on his mind.
Yeah, I'm hoping so, too. Mom, I will be careful.
No, you won't. That's the problem. You're just so gullible. Is that all you're having?
What? Yes, I can't stay. I've got an appointment. And I've got to pack.
An appointment with whom?
Nobody you know.
What? I thought Dr. Jive was getting married.
Mom, sometimes you are positively uncanny. How do you do it?
Well, is it Fred or not?
No. It's his fiancée. But believe me, it is in my best interest.
This is bound to be intriguing.
Well, I want him out of my life. Now, the only way that can happen is if this wedding comes off. So, really, I'm doing it for me.
Then do something for me. Skip it. You don't need another broken-winged bird crying on your shoulder.
Mother, I hardly think that will happen. I mean, she's an athlete. She's solid as a rock. She can handle herself.
Really?
You know, it's amazing. Most women, after they've been crying for a while, they look terrible. But wait, is that some kind of a Norwegian miracle eyeliner you're wearing? No, I'm just kidding. I'm just trying to cheer you up. Do you think that you could, like, stop just heaving a little bit? You know, somehow I expected that you'd be a lot tougher. I mean, being a skier and all, just more competitive, more of a jock, you know?
Oh, you're...
But you're really very sweet.
You are sweet.
No, you, not me. At least I don't think of myself as sweet. I'm just older. Look, I just came by to talk to you about Fred, you know, sort of woman to woman.
Woman to woman?
Oh, Liv Ullmann.
Yes.
Anyway, I've been thinking about this quite a lot, and I'm going to say it anyway, even though you probably won't understand a single word. Maybe because I know him. I probably know him better than anybody else. Most people think of him as what? Just like a skinny guy who doesn't shave a lot. You know, Mr. Blues in the Night. But there's another side to him that's hidden. It takes time to find it. He's warm. He's kind. He's very caring. And he would give the shirt off his back to a total stranger. And has. And the way that he sees things, it's just different from any man that I've ever known. Of course, he's great. You know, well, that's pretty much all I had to say. Thank you. Thank you for your time.
Except, of course, he's unreliable. I mean, he lives in his own universe. He's got notes in his head. And that damn saxophone. Well, I mean, that's it, isn't it? I mean, he blows a few notes, a few riffs, and it's just so lyrical. It breaks your heart. It makes you think that anyone who can make music like that must be beautiful deep down in his soul. And I think maybe he is. I don't know, so you just start forgiving all kinds of things. I mean, he can't remember his own birthday, for God's sake. And then one day you wake up, and there he is. And he's in your skin, he's in your hair, your eyes. Until you can't see anymore, and it's just Fred. Makes you wonder how the one man in the whole world that makes you feel so alive is the very same one that makes you wish that you had never been born.
Oh, I guess I was rambling. You didn't get any of that, did you?
No, I bit.
Like all of it?
At speaking, I am not so good. At this, I am better.
That's the most important thing, isn't it?
That's quite...
Hi. Is Bill here? He mentioned something to me about dinner. Look, if this is a bad time, I could come back later. Well, that's certainly a beautiful robe.
Speaking of devils.
Bill, hi.
You see, did I not promise you she would come? 1, 2, 3, easy as bread.
So, what's cooking? More beautiful robes. I didn't realize you had so many relatives in town. Oh, gosh.
I imagine you're having many questions.
Oh, no, just one, really. Why?
Why not? In the garden of spices, the cinnamon and the coriander often mingle with the saffron.
Yeah, well, I read about that garden. I don't have much of a green thumb myself.
If you should please reconsider.
Gee, I don't think so. But I will tell you one thing, though. My mother will be thrilled.
Surprise.
Oh, no, not after the day I've had.
Yeah, me too.
Hey. My dad, Tex.
Yeah. Did you get the job? Gave it to him.
Oh, well, turn it down. The pay was good, but the fringe benefits were kind of dicey.
That's you all over, always looking for the perfect situation.
Uh-huh. Fred, I talked to Kirsten.
Yeah, so I hear. I appreciate it.
Well, I don't think it went too well. In fact, it might even be your basic unmitigated disaster.
No. You did fine. It all worked out pretty well, considering.
Considering what?
Considering the wedding's off.
Oh.
It's funny how it took us both a while to realize it. We're not really right for each other. Well, you saw. Anyway, goodbye to all that, right? I just came by to tell you I'm going out of town. Gonna be on tour, playing backup for a country western band.
Are you serious?
Would I be wearing this shirt if I was joking? And get this. What do you think?
I think it's stupid.
Yeah, that's what
well,
I
you
think.
You see, then, I think your regular clothes are pretty stupid, too.
Yeah? Yeah, I think that, too. So...
I hope.
See you, Molly.
See you, cowboy. I think we could get some sleep.
You don't like lullabies?
But you want to honk your horn, go in the living room.
No, it's too cold in there. I'll stick around. Maybe we'll find something to do. Molly, you still awake?
I am now.
I was just thinking. You want to get married? Molly?
I heard you.
So?
We'll talk about it tomorrow, okay?
Yeah, sure. Tomorrow'll be fine. Only how do I know you'll still be here tomorrow?
Don't worry. I'll be here.
Just because I'm her mother and I love her, she was beautiful. And is today. Although, here we are, almost 35 years later, and she's still crawling around in a world where most things seem to be just slightly out of reach. But in her own peculiar way, she gets by. Selling apartments, teaching piano, singing in saloons. Not the concert virtuoso her father thought she'd be. Or the orthopedic surgeon I hoped she'd be. But she manages. For a few months, she had success writing advertising jingles, but that went the way of her other lifetime careers. Now she's concentrating on her poetry. I don't have to tell you what glad tidings those are to any mother who's heard of Sylvia Plath. Oh, well, that's Molly. A little up in the air as she nears her 35th April. Incredible, really, because she was this toddler you see before you only yesterday. Where did it go? Molly's 35, which amazingly is only 5 years younger than I. Happy birthday, sweetheart. And try to stay on your feet.
Schroeder's passed out in the mail room.
Yes, I know.
Well, the boiler room's being fumigated. He's got to lie down somewhere.
Yeah, well, I mean, I guess the superintendent of the building can lie down wherever he likes, huh?
Oh, that ain't true, Mr. Hart. You got to draw a line somewhere.
Davey, I've got to tell you something.
But then every man has his breaking point. His was when Judd Hirsch left the original cast of I'm Not Rappaport. Hasn't been the same since.
Davey.
Schroeder, I mean, not Judd. Judd hasn't changed.
Davey, my poem was published, damn it.
Really? Which one?
The one called Destiny?
Oh, yeah. Not one of your best.
Oh, really, Mr. Critic? Well, you see, they obviously thought differently because they published it.
And who might they be?
The Boise Journal.
I don't believe I'm familiar with that publication.
Ah, well, you see, it's a semi-annually published collection of new works by, as yet, undiscovered talents.
From Idaho?
What? Like the heartland of America hasn't produced some pretty air writers?
Let me thumb through it.
Maybe it's just me, but is this the slowest ride in recorded elevator history?
Oh, I'm sorry, Miss Dodd. Hang on to your hat. Interesting publication. Unusual format. Lots of tractor and combine ads. Pictures of Guernseys and Holsteins. I like the way they enclose the poems in them little silos and corrals. Kind of thing you don't see in the Atlantic Monthly. I find it refreshing.
Yeah, well, I'm sorry you're so jaded that you can't feel joy and excitement for another human being.
I'm turning cartwheels for you, Miss Dodd. I just don't want you to get so intoxicated by the sweet nectar of success that you forget about the sour juice of failure.
Yeah, well, I can count on you to keep me humble. You know, I'm not leaving this elevator until you say something nice.
You could be taking a big risk.
Try me.
Okay, then. Happy birthday, Miss Dodd.
That's so much better. Thank you very much.
What are you going to be, 38, 39?
35.
You don't say. Well, I'm racing down to the newsstand for a copy of the Destiny edition of the Boise Journal. If they ain't sold out already.
Oh, I've already eaten the hot and sour soup. The spicy eggplant is cold because 1 o'clock came and went an hour and 15 minutes ago. But happy birthday.
Well, thank you, Nina. Thank you, Robin. However, as it happens, we were supposed to meet at Wing Pang.
Don't be silly. We always meet at Li Fong on your birthday.
No, Wing Pang. Li Fong is your birthday.
Han Ling is my birthday. Wing Pang is Robin's. You're Li Fong. We've been doing this for 15 years. How could there be any question?
Robin?
Oh, don't ask me. I came on blind faith. Besides, you hate Wing Pang ever since the safety pin and the twice cooked pork.
No, it wasn't a safety pin. It was a paperclip. But let me just say how pleased as punch I am to finally be here.
Well, now that we're gathered, how about a little toast? To the eldest of the three musketeers.
Wait, when did I get to be the eldest?
Because I'm considerably younger than you by well over 3 weeks. And I'm still 25 because it's still 10 years ago in New Jersey. If you don't stop shoveling that stuff down, you won't live to see 26. I'm like a buzzsaw. I'm hungry all the time.
Well, maybe you're pregnant. What? What, is that it? Did I get it? Well, I was going to ask for all the news, but I certainly wasn't expecting this.
It's your birthday. Let's talk about your news.
No, my news can wait. This is wonderful.
No, really, it isn't.
Of course it is. I mean, I know you weren't planning on another one, but... Oh, I mean, Russ must be proud as a peacock.
Russ and I have separated.
Oh, my God. Well, are you serious? Separated? Well, when did this happen? Why didn't somebody tell me? This is terrible. I mean, you and Russ are perfect. Kids in the house? I mean, you did so much work on that place. I mean, what's going on? I mean, there's got to be some kind of misunderstanding. I just don't know what to say.
Well, you're making it all a lot easier.
Well, this is unbelievable. I am just stunned. But, I mean, it can't all be ashes. I mean, you're pregnant. Well, she is really pregnant.
She's really pregnant.
Russ is a great father, Robin, and if he's going through a little trouble dealing with another...
Russ and I haven't slept together in 2 years.
Well, that's okay, too. A lot of marriages can... Oh.
Ask her who the lucky father is.
Oh, I don't really...
Terry's little league coach. Divorced father of two. Lives down the block. He's kind of a jerk. Maybe we should have all joined the Peace Corps back in the days when we were young enough to hurl ourselves in front of bulldozers. But no, I had to go for a slice of American pie. Oh, come on. This isn't a wake, it's a celebration. The 35th year of you, of us.
Peaks and valleys, warts and all.
Well, I must say you're taking this all very lightly.
Oh, I don't mind. Misery loves company.
What? What? What is it? Is it something bad?
Ramon. It appears he's gone back to Chile.
Oh, Nina, I am so sorry.
No, you're not. You never liked him.
No, but you did, and that's what's important. Even though he didn't treat you very well.
He's Latin. He's fiery.
Yeah, he behaved like a pig.
Yeah, but he's my pig. And now he's gone, and I don't think he's ever coming back.
Well, even though I'm sorry, I must say, I think it's for the best. I think you deserve better. And believe me, you will recover.
Ask her why he left. His parents were killed in a mudslide.
I see. Are you two doing this to me on purpose? Okay, because we did say Wing Pang. Look, I wasn't going to mention it, but I do have some news.
We can always count on Molly for something traumatic.
Well, actually, this is good news. I've had a poem published. Well, now, it's just a little magazine, but it's in print, and it is definitely my poem, and I just feel euphoric. I've waited so long, as you two well know. Even though it may very well be the only time I ever get published. And, of course, it's very likely that it was printed by mistake. And it's not very good. And maybe I'll just fall into a depression and kill myself in a couple of days, okay?
Where's the stupid damn waiter with more bulk food? Egg rolls, pork things!
Well, golly.
Exactly setting fire to the newsstands in New York. Uh-huh. I ain't giving up, though. Going to scout out that foreign language kiosk over on Times Square.
Davey, what's this?
Got me. Is it ticking?
It's a birthday present, I think. Davey, is this from you?
I prefer to give the gift that keeps on giving. The pleasure of my company.
More than any woman has a right to expect.
Evidently, this is from a secret admirer. I imagine you got yourself a whole cache of them.
Yeah, gaggles.
On the other hand, it might be from one of them lunatic psychotics I've been reading about in the Post. You know, the types that go around forming abnormal attachments to public figures. Now that you're a literary celebrity, I suppose there's always a chance.
Davey, who lives in that apartment?
12F? Nobody lives in 12F. At least no one who rides in my elevator.
Well, no, I mean, somebody lives in there. They slam the door every time I walk past.
Come to think of it, I did see a guy ducking down the fire exit a couple of weeks ago. Looked like Raymond Burr in Rear Window, carrying parts of his wife in his suitcase. Want me to dispose of that for you?
No, I'm going to keep it.
I'd be careful. Might be anything. Dead rodent. Maybe part of a finger.
Do you believe everything you read?
Only the things that frighten the bejesus out of me. Pardon me if I don't stick around.
Attempting to bring a little joy into your birthday.
Mom, every year I ask you not to do this. I beg, I plead.
The tan box is a dust buster. The yellow is a blender. Just give me a few moments to freshen up before I go and jump out the window.
Ah, you're really not going to stay.
I am. I'm pooped.
Well, you must be from coming up with that Christmas carol idea.
And from walking up and down the stairs trying to find an apartment.
Where?
Here.
For whom?
Mom and Daddy. Mamie. Oops, it was supposed to be a surprise. Let's just say we've been having an adventure and leave it at that.
Mamie?
Well, we can't just go on sneaking around right under Molly's nose. And honestly, you wouldn't believe what wonderful places they have right here in this building. So full of air and light and so cleverly laid out. Not like your place at all.
Don't you have something to do?
How long will I have to stay in there?
Give us a minute, sis.
I suppose I could do my eyes.
Mother, give me one good reason why out of 10 zillion dwelling units in this city, you have picked my building.
If you don't want me to live near you, dear, just say so. Okay?
I don't want you to live near me.
You don't mean that.
Oh, but I do.
You know, in some societies, the elderly are revered.
Not here. Here, we just put them out on an iceberg and cut them adrift.
For your information, Miss Stoneheart, there are daughters who enjoy living with their mothers.
Mom?
See, you already got one of those trapped in that bathroom. Why get greedy?
There's a difference. Mamie doesn't need me, you do.
Can I come out now?
In a minute, dear.
Now, are you trying to tell me that that person doesn't need you?
She just thinks she does. But really, Mamie does quite well all on her own. Don't kid yourself. She's thrilled that we're moving away.
So I guess that just leaves me, your unsettled, unfinished, unhusbanded orphan child.
I just want you to be happy. Don't think of me as a mother. Think of me as a friend.
Mother, I've got friends. Scads of them. Buckets. Well, for example, Nina.
I'm no friend of yours.
Well, then maybe you could be my mother.
Here. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Florence.
Nina, what's wrong?
Nothing.
Would you like to tell me about it?
No.
Ah, well then. Here we are. Just a bunch of white chicks sitting around, not talking.
Hello.
Hi, Mamie.
Hi, Nina. What brings you here?
She's not saying.
Yes, I am. Did you know that your sister...
Oh, that would be me.
...is the most insensitive, unfeeling, callous human being ever to walk the face of this earth?
Oh, sure, I knew that.
And have you ever had a best friend tell you that she despises the man you love and everything he stands for?
All the time.
What'd you do about it?
Tic-tacs.
Tic-tacs?
Those little peppermint breath fresheners? I know it sounds crazy, but whenever I'm feeling blue, something's wrong at the house, or Len is being sued again, I just pop one into my mouth, and I get this kooky kind of feeling.
All right, that's enough.
You know, I think I have some in my purse.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please?
Get one for me, too, dear.
All right, that's it. Don't listen. Look, I have something to say. I am going to say it if I have to say it to those damn walls. Now, am I making myself understood?
Good. Well, then, take a seat. Today is my 35th birthday. Now, I mean, that's not a milestone. It's not like 70 or 100, not even like 316. But for some reason, this birthday is different for me.
That is a cute scarf.
Mamie. Sorry. Anyway, something's happened, and I think I know what it is. I am content. I mean, not clicking my heels, laughing out loud, but I am content. For the first time in a long, long while. It's very odd, because I'm not at all where I thought I'd be when I was 35. I mean, I am not rich, I'm not famous. I'm not the youngest kid on the block anymore. And the handsome prince that I married turned out to be a pumpkin when the clock struck 12. But there are other things that I've done right, things that I have that are mine. Like friends who hate me. A mother who thinks I'm a child, and a family that defies description. But these things are not nothing. These things are very precious to me. They're part of a life, my life. And my life, is like what? Well, it's like this. The wrapping is a little messy. God knows what's inside. And I have no idea where this came from. But you see, that's the whole point. It just appeared on my doorstep. No bugles, no fanfares, just from out of nowhere. Serendipity. I like that. So, thank you for listening. And to conclude, I'd like to read a poem that I had published. And after that, I want you all to leave. This is the poem. It's called Destiny, and it's by Molly Bickford Dodd. Gently spinning, silently turning,
plucked from far stars uncharted, through blue azimuth and the white of white nimbus, it falls like sheets on a new bride's bed. And I am the bride, patient, waiting, hearing only the rustle of time and promise, while outside in the courtyard, the clang of revelers celebrating comes close. Thank you. I love you all very much. And good night.
Charges.
Hey, Fred.
No, it's okay. I figured it was you. What's up?
You did? Oh, well, thanks for remembering. Yeah? Well, that's nice to hear. Yeah, well, as a matter of fact, I kind of miss you, too. No, I'm fine. What? I've got a cake burning in the refrigerator. I'm making myself a cup of tea. There's rain in the forecast. Where are you? El Paso? It's kind of noisy down there, isn't it? What? Yeah, well, that's what it's all about. Days and nights. Well, you get some sleep, pal. Mm-hmm. Yeah, me too. So long.
To laundry night in New York City. Not just for my daughter, Molly Dodd, but for every other tenant willing to risk life and limb in that basement for the privilege of having their clothes ripped to shreds by machines that haven't worked properly since the Nixon administration. Space being at a premium down there, it helps to have a sixth sense about that moment when a dryer becomes available. Molly does not. Her instincts run more to art, music, and the uncanny ability to choose the wrong men. Now, as basements go, this particular one on a scale of 1 to 10 for safety probably rates about a 4. And while you may not see deranged, drooling escape maniacs who look like Quasimodo hiding under the dryer, I don't know as I'd linger in that bat cave too long, much less feel honor-bound to fold other people's clothes. Molly doesn't even fold her own clothes. Her dresser drawer looks like it's been hit by something measuring 6.7 on the Richter scale. But look what she's doing. Good thing she doesn't have a steam iron. She'd probably press those very attractive shorts, which look like they belong to Bozo or some other clown not unlike her ex-husband. Now, we don't know where those clothes have been, so let's just hope the heat from the spin cycle has killed whatever pesky little germs were lurking in those jeans. I think she's entitled to a dollar for all her trouble, don't you? But no, Molly would say it's stealing and wouldn't sleep for the rest of her life. Of course, when she returns later to retrieve her own laundry, she'll find it scattered all over the place with a note pinned to her panty saying, "I'm watching you." You think I'm kidding? That's why I live in the suburbs. Out there, you know who the lunatics are. They're your neighbors. But at least they're out in the open where you can see them.
Doing anything, check the editorial on nuclear proliferation. The Times is against it. See you.
Davey, wait! I locked myself out of my apartment.
Well, why would you want to do a thing like that? Especially dressed the way you are, which is scanty, to say the least. What with the weather turning nippy and all?
Davey, the doorknob came off in my hand. Do you think you can help me?
I'm not sure that falls within my jurisdiction. Now, if it rolled into the elevator, at your service.
Apartment 12E, the apartment next to mine. Do you know who lives there?
No, never seen a soul. But if I had to guess, I'd say it was four black fellas. Got themselves a band. They rehearse that song all the time. Got it down pat. Want to wear my jacket?
No, I want to get back into my apartment.
Yeah, I wouldn't wear it if I didn't have to. Kind of gamey.
Maybe there's a screwdriver somewhere.
I suppose I could wash it. Then you lose that new feeling.
You know, if I could just get some pliers, I could turn that little tumbler thing in the door.
Needle nose.
What?
You need a pair of needle nose pliers.
Oh. Well, yeah. Where can I get them?
You can't at this hour.
What about the super?
3:30 a.m., passed out in the boiler room.
You could try to wake him.
I could try and wake him. I am half naked here, Debbie.
Oh, you can't see anything. Except when the light hits a certain way. No, but I can still make out the shape of... Hop in, folks. Just gotta run a little lady down to the basement for a second. Unless one of you has your toolkit on you.
Morning.
Morning.
I maybe got 6 seconds of sleep last night. Well, I know why I'm irritable, but what's her problem? Excuse me. You probably know I quit my job here last week, and I am, therefore, no longer an employee of Dennis Widmer and Associates. But I am not dead. Perhaps some clients have tried to reach me in the past few days. Would you happen to know if any such calls have come in? No. Does anyone know if any such calls have come in? Does anybody know why everybody is being so hostile?
You're getting out.
We're stuck here.
Kane threatens us.
So does Strength. Cheers was cute last night. Dennis.
Molly.
Dennis.
Claire. Claire, I'd like to meet my wife, Molly. Molly, I don't believe you met my wife, Claire. Claire, this is Molly. Molly, this is Claire. Claire, just came by for lunch. Molly, it's a complete surprise. Have you eaten?
I just came to get my last commission check, if it's all right with you, and even if it isn't.
Well, it is, but you can't, you know, get your money just yet. Perhaps we could meet around 4, and I could give you some sort of explanation.
All I want you to give me is my money. Dennis, it's my money. I earned it, so give it to me now.
Claire, will you excuse us?
Oh, I'm not even listening.
Little labor dispute.
Did you say something?
You can't leave me like this.
Oh, here with your wife. Is that what you mean?
Molly, she's not a wife to me. Not really.
God.
All right, maybe according to Webster in the state of New York. But not by the laws and definitions set down by soulmates in the wee hours of the afternoon and early evening. Those are the only ones that mean anything, Molly. Claire, have you seen our new pretzel jar?
Dennis, if you don't give me my check right now, I am going to tell Claire about every single one of those wee hours.
I can't give you the check today. It has to go through a special account.
That is just an excuse to keep me hanging around, because you know that once I get that check, I am out of this office and your life forever.
I swear to you, it really has to go through a special account. God, if I could just kiss your knees right now, I'd be the happiest man alive.
Claire?
Claire, we brew decaf now. Is that all you and I are to each other? 6 grand and change?
Give me my check.
I will. As soon as we've had time to discuss it. Right now, I have a very important and urgent meeting to get to. I'll walk you out.
I'm not going out.
I thought you had an appointment.
No, you have an appointment.
That's his, maybe if I appear pathetic now, I can score later look. Not to be confused with his, maybe if I appear totally helpless without her, she'll mother me for the rest of my life look. The longer you know him, the easier they are to distinguish. You also find yourself gagging less. Self-preservation.
Nice to meet you.
Likewise. Finally.
Finally.
Dennis has talked about you a lot. In his sleep, he babbles. You're quite a woman.
Yes, well, I've achieved quite a lot career-wise over the last few years.
No, the achievement that I was referring to took place at the Bally High Motor Lodge in Greenport. He tends to get specific when he babbles.
I just want you to know that I never knew that he was. The whole time that we...
Oh, it's a decent place. Nice amenities. It's where it takes most of them. You know, that is one of the few motels on Long Island with built-in refrigerators, which is great for women like you and me who like to eat like a horse afterwards.
Hi.
Ha, ha.
Is this your apartment? I guess that makes you Molly Dodd.
Wait, you got a little doorknob problem here.
Oh, my God.
Hey,
I
don't blame yourself. This thing is old. I mean, it's just a hunk of junk.
Junk?
Ma'am, you do speak English, don't you?
Oh, yes, I do. I just haven't used it yet. Would you like to come in for a cold drink?
Hey, yeah, I understand that just fine.
Please.
You're gonna need it. Hey, nice place.
Thank you. So, you're a locksmith.
Yeah.
Oh, that must be fascinating.
Oh, yeah. See, I was afraid I was gonna have to be a thoracic surgeon, but, well, luckily I got into a good locksmith school, so.
Now, what I meant was, I mean, it must involve a certain amount of expertise and craftsmanship.
Oh, tons. Well, like, you might not know whether you want a red key or a blue key. I could advise you.
I bet you could.
You're real pretty when you're normal.
Would you like something to eat? I have a very nice roast in the freezer. We could wash it off and cook it.
Thanks. I gotta leave in a minute. Okay, well, here's the deal on the door. See, the retainer that holds the knob is broken, which means that the spring that keeps it in the opposition won't retract, so the whole knob's gonna have to be replaced.
Ah, well, I'll see you when you come back to install it.
Well, you'll see someone, though. Probably not me. I'm leaving for my honeymoon Saturday.
Honey, what?
Moon. Going to the Poconos, you know, heart-shaped beds, complimentary champagne mirrors. It's hot. Hey, don't worry, though. We won't leave you hanging.
You know, ideally, sushi should be experienced while drinking sake. But in the case of a sushi virgin like yourself, I think we'll forgo that tradition and guzzle as much cheap wine as possible.
Thank you, Nina. That's what I was planning on doing.
Look, why don't you try the mackerel? It tastes just like chicken.
Raw chicken.
Oh, come on, take a chance. Look, it's an acquired taste.
Yes, well, calves' brains are an acquired taste, but I'm going to forego that pleasure. Thank you very much.
When'd you become so finicky? I remember when we were little kids, I got you to eat that caterpillar. You didn't even flinch.
Yeah, well, we cooked that caterpillar first. You cook that stuff, we'll discuss it.
My mother says if you never take chances, you never learn new dance.
Yeah? Well, my mother always said, keep away from Nina Shapiro's mother. She's a Democrat.
You know what I think? I think this abnormal fear of fish kind of represents the entire rut your life has fallen into lately.
Oh, well, I mean, it's easy to point a finger when you're sitting in the catbird seat. You have a stimulating job, a wonderful boyfriend who, as far as I can tell, is not married. And to add insult to injury, you've never had to pluck an eyebrow in your whole life.
Well, for your information, I lost my stimulating job this afternoon.
Nina, why didn't you say something?
Maybe because I've got a better one starting tomorrow.
That is so obnoxious. You don't even take time to be depressed.
Exactly, my dear, and neither should you. You can turn your whole life around if you just listen to me.
What?
Hey, who is doing that, and why?
Nina, it is all part of the big picture. A soul in turmoil, spinning out of control. My love life is bankrupt, not to mention my checkbook. And my walls are exploding.
Well, you've always got your best pal.
Yeah, whose idea of consolation is to shove parasite-infested marine life down my throat. We need more of this. Mom!
Oh, drinking alone, dear.
No, Florence. I'm here.
Even better. Two women drinking alone.
Hello, Nina. How's your mother?
Still left of center.
Mom, you just in time for a little dead raw fish. Oh, boy. I've just been to St. Vincent, visiting Ruth Bazer's daughter. You remember her?
No.
Of course you do.
No, I don't.
Well, maybe she was your sister's girlfriend. Anyway, she just had a little baby girl, her third, and she's only 29. No stretch marks.
That's impossible. Well, I have stretch marks, and I don't have any babies.
Is that going to end soon?
Well, we have chosen to ignore it.
It's an experiment, Florence, to see just how unbearable We can let things get before we decide to do something about it.
Wallowing in self-pity, are we?
We are not.
See, we have been virtually combing through the classifieds.
Baloney.
No, look, Mother, there are so many jobs here, I don't know where to begin.
I'm a pro at this. At first, we disregard anything that says partial nudity required, or earn big bucks in your own home. Which leads us to...
No, I will not be an Amway representative.
Is this what a rock concert sounds like? Because I hate it.
Yeah, it only goes on 24 hours a day.
You know, Molly, you don't have to put up with this.
Yes, Mother, what would you like me to do? Set myself on fire? Call a SWAT team?
There. See how easy things are?
If you need me, I'll be hiding in the bathroom.
Yes, I will be under the bed.
I better clean this up.
What are you doing, Dennis, you little worm?
Nothing.
You're tampering with my mailbox. I am shocked.
Well, now you know the feeling. Heart jolted out of its socket. Left alone to sputter and die.
Well, sputter and die in someone else's lobby. I want my check.
Well, believe it or not, your check's in the mail. No, really. It's in your actual mailbox. But in my haste to mail it after a discussion yesterday, I think I might have neglected to sign it.
Yes? Well, after you've gone, I'll examine it and I'll let you know. Did you really send me my money?
Well, not me personally. One of the idiots in the office sent it by mistake. That's all. I figured, as long as I'm here...
Get away from me, Dennis.
Okay, then let me just kiss your laundry.
Dennis, back off. Just back off. I want to get my check.
You know, I tried to do this thing legitimately.
Oh.
I asked the postman to give it to me. I told him you and I just started living together and hadn't gotten around to putting up the piece of dymo tape, and we were so intoxicated with the joy of cohabitation.
You cannot even lie like a decent human being. You couldn't have just told him you were my husband, could you? Thief, felon.
Molly. I want you to know you'll always have a place at Dennis Widmer and Associates. Everyone there loves you.
Everyone there hates me.
That's what I meant, but Dennis Widmer loves you.
No, what Dennis Widmer really loves is controlling and manipulating women.
That's not true. Are you wearing a bra?
Give me that damn check. Thank you. Solid oak furniture at factory direct prices. This is not it.
Even now, there are sparks between us. Can't you feel the crackle of excitement, the sexual tension?
Yes, right, Dennis. I am in heaven. Now, will you tell me again how great it is to be the other woman?
It is. You're sitting on top of the world. You can't even see it.
Check. A message from Art Linkletter.
Do you know what wives get from their husbands that you don't? Hmm. His colds, his dirty dishes, his laundry. You women, the ones who complain about how tired you are, about being second in his life. You're the ones who get the best half of men like me.
What makes you think half of you is such a bargain?
That half was more than enough for you at the Valley High Motor Lodge. Come on, babe, admit it. You need me just as much as you need this check. That's $6,000.
Hey, that is a bargain if I never, ever have to set eyes on you. There's nothing to worry about here. Bankers understand symbolic gestures. What happened to the six? Where is the damn six? Okay.
Thank you.
Is this too loud?
What?
The music.
The music is fine. Very handsome. The song is handsome. And the group. All four of them? My personal favorite.
I like them too.
I like them too. Did you just say that?
Mm-hmm.
Isn't it amazing how we both love the Beach Boys? I mean, I could listen to them all night long.
Me too.
Me too. Huh? Is it Japanese, or did you buy it?
Coming up, it's Friday night. The weather's freezing. Brave young souls are outside sneezing. Wind is howling. Folks are wheezing. Where is Molly? Inside, tweezing. Blair Brown stars in another half hour of The Days and Nights of Molly Dodd. Next, right here, only on Lifetime.
That's Molly Dodd, a frequent passenger of mine. Me being Davy McQuinn, the elevator man or builder. I'm really in charge of the entire premises. That includes your basement, 14 floors, and your roof, which is where I spend a lot of my off hours, because that's where I got my birds. 30 homing pigeons and 2 doves. Been breeding them since my bantamweight days in Queens. Kind of like Marlon Brando in On the Waterfront. The difference being that I really was a contender. Now, back then, when we were all making a living with our fists, Miss Dodd was the type of gal you'd like to have in your corner. A battler who'd have a shot of Jameson's with you once in a while without getting all sloppy. And she's a redhead, which is a real bonus. Though she calls it Titian. Kind of like Maureen O'Hara, who in my day was a girl you'd throw yourself in front of a trolley for. She's got real dignity. Miss Dodd, I mean. And she can take a punch. Anyway, like I said, now that my fighting days are over, I'm an elevator man. Which, contrary to public opinion, doesn't have as many ups and downs as you might think. Sometimes it's just tedium. The only way to fight it is to keep in shape. But of course, you do lose track of time, so maybe I should get back up to the roof. I got a couple of pigeons due in from Nassau County. It's a perilous flight. And it's nice when there's somebody there to greet them.
So inexorable pestilence creeps and sweeps and fills the darkling night with cries of shattered bone and skull and women watering their plants. And what of the children, puling progeny parched on pillows, writhing in their wretchedness? Alas, weep, weep ye.
That's the end of Canto 3.
Very inspirational, Mr. Hellman. One
little comment, however. The next time you sit down to write poetry, think about killing yourself instead. So, who's next? Come on. There must be one of you festering with some little germ of a thought that would enlighten us all. No. Well, in that case, I see by the old clock on the wall.
Mr. Mano?
Duke.
May I ask you a question?
Why not?
I know you're a very famous poet. I mean, you've published 16 volumes, and that you hang around with people like George Plimpton, and that this class is probably very, very boring to you.
That's not a question.
Maybe this is all just a big joke to you. But, you know, there are some of us here who have struggled for years just to produce anything at all. And good, bad, or mediocre. Well, I believe we deserve some respect just for trying.
That's telling him.
I see. In other words, you want me to say nice things, comforting things, pats on the head.
Well, no, I mean, I didn't...
No? You brought it up. So, just to show you that I am not an ogre, I do have something nice to say. One of you, I am happy to tell you, has finally written a poem that shows promise.
Who is it?
You're looking at her.
Me?
Miss Dodd here came to me tonight before class and said that she had written something that was a little personal, then wasn't sure she wanted to expose herself in front of all of you. Isn't that right, Miss Dodd? And you know, I think she was wise to do that because this poem is so disturbing in the nakedness of its imagery, so profound in the furious bucking of its passion that to read it here before all of you would be like casting pearls before swine. I bid you all good night. You've made me very, very tired.
This is not how it seems. You know, we're really not in cahoots. I am one of you.
Sure you are.
Well, that was really, really unfair.
What's that?
What you did. You really get a kick out of humiliating people, don't you?
Did it ever occur to you that I might have been sincere?
I mean, you really liked it? You really liked it?
It was hot. It was alive. I like that.
Well, I know it's a little rough around the edges, but I mean, if you think it shows promise.
Promise? It's the only breath of fresh air I've breathed in this vomitorium since we started.
Well, I did work pretty hard on it.
I'm flying out to Frisco next weekend for the American Poets Conference, and there's enough money in the budget for me to take along a student. You interested? Bukowski's going to be there, and Dillard. I think you might enjoy meeting them.
Next weekend. Well, I'm sure I can make some arrangements.
You don't have to do anything. I'll book us a room.
Oh. Really?
It's all so predictable, isn't it, Miss Dodd? And I want you to know how much I hate myself at this moment.
I don't blame you.
So, you want to meet me at the airport?
No.
Okay, then why don't we just duck into the broom closet?
Oh. Read this.
I'm reading this.
Read this instead. Done?
Yep.
Is it genius?
Nope.
That's what I thought. Now we can go.
Boy, I always suspected them art critics had it easy.
Oh.
Thinking about biting someone, Miss Dodd?
As a matter of fact, I am.
Somebody I know?
Men.
I see. Any man in particular?
All men in particular.
That's a lot of biting. Maybe you should narrow it down. Say, leave out the ones under 12 and over 85. Any way you look at it, it's going to be murder on the teeth.
Davy, I'm retiring.
From men?
No, from poetry.
This is a red letter day.
I'm just sick of it, you know? I'm sick of the hypocrisy, I'm sick of the rejection, I'm sick of the slime. You know, I just don't want to be involved in it any longer.
I see. So you're quitting?
No, I'm not quitting. I'm retiring.
You're going to write poetry anymore?
No.
Then you're quitting. It's okay. I can see why you might want to cash in your chips. The literary life can be one of loneliness and desperation.
Well, that's exactly why I'm getting out.
On the other hand, one day John Irving and I were wrestling up at the 92nd Street Y. I had him in some sort of chokehold, no question about it. And he screams to me, "Davy! Davy! Garp!" Or something like that. I dropped him to the mat and said, "John, that's it." And do you know by midnight he had 15 chapters written?
Davy, I know what you're doing, but I have made up my mind. I am out of the literary market.
There's going to be a lot of long faces over at Random House.
Go play with your pigeons.
Not half as annoying as a talent snuffed before its prime.
Who is it? Baby?
Here I am.
You said chickens. Doesn't that imply more than one?
Well, it's just an expression, Molly. It's only me.
Where's Mom?
Mom?
Yeah.
You know, our mother, about 5'6", 130 pounds, red-headed fury.
I know who Mom is.
Well, she's not out there.
Well, yeah, well, where does it say I can't visit my sister without dragging Mom along?
Mimi, what's wrong?
Nothing's wrong, silly. I just sort of popped into my car for a little spin, and my wanderings brought me here. So, can I come in?
You bet.
Thank you.
So, here it is. Molly's place. All these cunning little touches.
Why are you here?
Nothing cohesive, no real theme, yet somehow...
Maybe.
Wild horses couldn't drag you into Manhattan without an armed escort. What's going on? Is there trouble at home?
Oh, my God. No, is it the kids? Is it Len?
Is it another malpractice suit?
No, it is not that. It's our home. Yours and mine and Mom's and Dad's.
I don't understand.
Oh, what do you care? What do you care that I risk life and limb driving into that awful tunnel with those horrible men with their squeegee squirting water all over my car?
Mamie.
Just to tell you that there's a terrible crisis going on right under your nose and you don't even know about it.
You don't tell me what you're talking about immediately. I'm going to go and call Mom.
Because she's the artistic type. Don't tell Molly. That's what everybody says. She's so darn fragile.
I am picking up the phone.
What? Don't do that. I'll tell. Could I just have a drink of water first? Mom wants to move to Manhattan, and Dad doesn't, and they've been arguing about it for days. And now Dad's taken to his bed, and he hasn't talked since last Thursday.
Because Mother wants to move to Manhattan?
And Dad doesn't.
So he's not talking?
Mm-mm, not to Mom, not to me, and he won't talk to you either.
Mamie, this is not good news.
Oh, it's tragic news on a lot of levels. For one thing, what if I need Mom to babysit? I'll have to drag the kids all the way into New York.
Yeah, well, I never thought of that before.
I said on a lot of levels. Let's face it, this could be a catastrophe. Mm. Oh, Molly, tell me it's going to be all right.
Oh, it's going to be all right.
You know, I was noticing those lamps. If they came in a more cheerful color, they'd look nice in the kids' room.
Welcome to the crypt.
Daddy? It's us, your family. Papa, speak to us. You see, He won't say a word to anyone.
Hi, Dad.
Hi, Molly.
Thank heavens! He's come back to us!
Praise the Lord. Dad, what's up? What are you doing?
Oh, nothing. I'm just watching the world go by.
Ask him if he wouldn't like to watch it from the living room so I can change the bed.
Tell her just to pull the sheets over my head, wrap me up, and throw me out with all her other unwanted relics.
No, I am not going to tell her that.
Oh, I'll tell her. Mom, Dad would like you to...
Sorry. Just trying to help. At least change your pajamas.
That's right. Change. Change everything.
Well, Dad, come on. It's just your pajamas.
If I take these off, she'll give them away. These are mine, and I'm keeping them. What brings you out our way, Pumpkin?
Pumpkin? I'm just trying to understand what all this is about.
She's moving us out. Kit and caboodle, lock, stock, and barrel, the whole ball of wax.
I can't believe the production he's making out of this.
She's phoned every real estate agent on the East Coast.
I have made some inquiries for the good of both of us.
Manhattan. What does it cost to ride the subway in Manhattan? $5. And a pretzel. What's a pretzel? $10, $15. $20 to ride the subway and eat a pretzel. That's where she's going to move us.
It'll save his life.
I'll be dead in 10 seconds. The woods are burning, boys.
Oh, it must be one of those great big pretzels. So the situation is this. You're moving, you're not.
In a nutshell.
We're both moving.
You can't seal up my entire life in a crate. You can't box me up and ship me out like you're going to do to that old stuff in the attic.
You're giving away everything in the attic? And I should have done that years ago. Everything? Just a lot of junk, anyway.
Well, shouldn't Molly and I have a chance to sort of rummage through it first?
Take anything you want.
Well, come on, Molly. What are we waiting for?
Oh, what do you say you get started without me?
Yeah, but it might be fun to do it together. And there might be something, you know, that you want, that I want, too.
You know, I don't think I want anything you want.
Well, you heard her. First tip for me.
Brimming with sentiment, just like her mother.
All right, Ozzie, Harriet... What's going on here? Is there any way we can resolve this issue?
What issue?
Oh, come on!
Well, tell her, Florence. You're calling the shots here.
It has become clear to me in the past several months that your father's retirement is threatening to...
I interfere with her lifestyle.
At least I function.
I function. I'm as busy as a beaver.
Yes. Well, then why don't we just get a respirator in here in case you're too busy to breathe?
Oh, Roger, you're missing out. It's a treasure trove up here.
You know what I find hard to believe? That all of this means nothing to you.
All of what?
The glory years, the salad days. This place was paradise then. And the memories.
Oh, here we go.
Patter of little footsteps. Building the patio in the backyard. You could fill up your gas tank for $2. And you knew your neighbors.
You hated your neighbors.
Not all the neighbors.
Most of the neighbors.
I loved Eddie Palillo. I helped save his tree in the big hurricane in 58. We used to drink Rheingold on his back porch.
He stole your hedge clippers. His son tried to rape me.
I'm going to the John.
Well, that's something.
But before I do, I want to share a little story with you about the day your mother and I moved into this old house.
You will not share that story, Edgar.
Mother, it's okay. I'm almost an adult.
Now, we had packed you and your brother and sister off to your grandparents, and it was July, and hotter than blazes. And that afternoon, there was a terrific thunderstorm. Real boomer. And we'd been unpacking all day, and we were feeling a little sweaty. So we took a break.
Is this really necessary? Oh, I think it is. I think this is going to be a breakthrough.
Things are a lot different around here. There's all fields out the back. The yard, and then the fence, and then the fields. And the rain was coming down in sheets. It felt wonderful. Remember, Florence, we got drenched. Soaked through to the skin. So, right out there by that big elm tree, which is now Norman Farbstein's hot tub, we took off all our clothes and we ran naked as jaybirds, laughing the whole time. And then we lay down in the clover and the honeysuckle. And we made love until I thought my entire...
Oh, my God.
Oh, you encouraged him.
What?
In any event, I hope I made my point.
Absolutely, yes.
Don't touch that bit.
So, right under the old elm tree, Emma. He was goofy with the heat that day, Molly.
Maybe I tempted him.
Anyway, I don't remember. It was the 50s.
Well, now it's the 80s, and I guess he doesn't want it to be.
Yes, but it is.
Mom, do you know what's going to happen if you move to Manhattan?
Yes, I know what's going to happen. Mamie is going to lose a babysitter.
My ears are burning.
It's not a fait accompli, but I had to do something. His retirement is killing him, and me too.
These should be my golden years, and I'd just as soon not spend them watching him watch Hulk Hogan.
Molly! Molly, can you help me with this? It's awfully heavy.
Well, you just about picked everything clean, Mame.
Oh, there's plenty more where that came from. And look, don't you just love this Indian?
No, I hate this. I've always hated it. It scared me.
Oh, well, me too, but Len might like it. Woo! Maybe I can put it in my front yard.
Yeah, you get rid of the jockey.
Hey, what are you doing with my Indian?
Well, I was going to take it home.
You're not taking it anywhere.
Edgar, you haven't looked at that thing for 30 years.
Well, it's high time I did. It's mine, and I want it. In fact, I want it right here, so I can look at it a lot.
Well, come on, Mame. Let's get this thing in bed where it belongs.
What else you got in the box, Mamie?
Yo, Mamie, what do you got in the box?
You know, this is really very stupid.
Hey, where do you think you're going with those bocce balls?
I don't know. I just thought they might be fun for the kids.
They stay.
Go ahead, Edgar. See if you can put your whole past on my side of the bed.
What else you got in there?
Let's see. Ah, one Perry Como Christmas in Vermont album.
Whoa. Stay.
One Waffle Iron GE circa 1962 sans cord.
Right here.
One pair of broken goggles from Pompano Beach, Florida.
Absolutely critical. Hey, speaking of Florida, what happened to my stuffed bluegill?
Oh, I left it up there because I know how much you love it.
I hate it. Always have. Take it.
Mom, I refuse to have any more to do with this charade. You can put the car in the bed for all I care. I'm going downstairs.
Good. Make some cookies.
I don't make cookies anymore.
Maybe this house needs a few cookies.
Okay. I'll make them. But you have to come downstairs to get them.
Put in some chocolate chips and we'll talk.
Come on, Mimi. I'm going downstairs with Mom. But before I do, there's something I want to tell you, Dad, and I don't care who knows it. I had a very happy childhood here, and I'm taking those damn bocce balls.
You want any of this crap?
Oh, no, I don't think so.
You know, your mother's getting to that point in her life when she has these weird mood swings. And this Manhattan thing is going to drive me up the wall.
Dad, she's just worried about you. She doesn't want you to stagnate. And she does not want you to stay in bed for the rest of your life.
I've been in bed for a couple of days. Why do I always have to get dressed? You haven't walked around in this pajamas for 30 years. Nobody ever said, hey, you, put your clothes on.
Just don't retire from everything. You're not that old.
I'm 60.
Well, that's not old.
I'd rather be 36 like you.
I'm not even 35.
So you got the world on a string. What do you know about getting old?
Well, I know about quitting. I almost stopped writing poetry. I just was going to quit cold.
Why would you do a thing like that? You've been writing poetry since you were 8.
7.
No, Molly, you're 36. We moved here 26 years ago when you were 10.
No, I was 9 years old. We moved here 25 years ago.
My God, a year of my life is missing.
Dad, I'm trying to tell you something very important.
What?
Well, I made a decision today. I'm going to keep writing poetry.
That's great. You write beautiful poetry.
So I'm going to keep writing poetry. You're going to stop living in the past, and we're going to go downstairs and have some cookies.
I don't see what one thing has to do with the other, but I'll go along with that. Especially since I just found out I'm 61.
So I'll see you downstairs.
It sounds like fun. Mm.
Mm. Ooh, maybe you could even shave.
Well, what do you want to watch, Chief? What about a little Hulkster, huh?